Okay, so I will just flash the tutorials. So some of these are routine exercise. Some of them has, you know, tricky parts with it. So if we can figure out those tricky issues, we can solve the problem in a fraction of a second. So the first problem is that three forces and a couple is shown that is applied on an angle bracket. We just want to first reduce the system to a force and a couple at B. And then ultimately we want to replace it by a single resultant. That single resultant, we want to know where it intersects the line AB and line BC. So basically, we have to find out the equation of the line and the intercept at the AB and BC.
Basically, we are finding out the point of action of the resultant force. And the moment of the resultant force about a point is equal to sum of the moments due to the components of the resultant force about a point. That is basically Varignon's theorem. Is there any specific reason as to why we are not acknowledging that name, Varignon's theorem?
No, it is not necessary, I mean, in that sense, because as such, you know, here we are just telling that we want to replace it by a resultant force and the moment resultant. I mean, there is no, you know, we are not really going into that deeper as such. These are x-intercept and y-intercept, right? That is what you are saying. No.
X is 10.24.
That's great, okay.
So and y is 4.3.
Yes. Now, kind of, we are hearing more answers. So just another 3 minutes, wrap it up. So the answer should be x-intercept, that is with the line AB, that is 10.3 centimeter. With line BC, it should be 4.36 centimeter.
Resultant moment should be 120 clockwise.
This is the force is 29.5. And this is the moment is clockwise 120 centimeter. Yes. According to distance, it is coming around 4.01 centimeter. The 4 centimeter.
Yeah, 4 centimeter above. 4.36 will be
that. That is x.
That is what?
X intercept.
X is 10.34 and y is 2.28 and that resultant is coming in the second quadrant.
So what I'll do, since I think we got the answers from
many of you.
So the answer, I think I have it all this thing in Word file. So just take a look if all the answers are, as you said, the moment at B, that is negative 120, that is clockwise. And we also have the resultant force, that is 29.866. So ultimately, the x-intercept we want to find in a similar way. So balance the moment about this axis right here, right? So this is the final solution we have. This picture right here, x-intercept and y-intercept, x is 10.3 and y is 4.36. And this resultant force, that will be 29, roughly, OK? Shall we move on to the next one? It's done. So earlier one was coplanar force system. Now we are in parallel force system. So for this problem, the line of action of the resultant force is actually known. So that's the condition given. And based on that, we have to find out where the fourth child is going to be placed on that raft.
Sir, 3.55
centimeter
from
MG. Along z-axis.
Yes.
Other one I have not yet done.
3.95 centimeter from
one answer was correct. The z required is along the z direction, we should have 3.55 meter.
At least two answers should be. Along x axis is 19.02.
Y axis it is 22.5.
No.
Along x axis from end E.
7.97 is something that sounds good. 7. Great. So answer was found now. So answer is actually along Z. It should be 3.55 meter. And along X, it should be 7.03 meter. So just 7 meter roughly, okay. So along the X, it should be 7 meter. Yeah, 7.03. Now I have the solution in pound foot. I mean, it is just the replacement, not the conversion. Basically, what was given is 85 pound and 60 pound like that. And also 15 foot and like that. So, but we don't have to convert. See, that's the equivalence system we are looking at. This is the first part of it. So the equivalence system is that what is already given, that resultant force must pass through the center of the raft, right? So 7.5 and 7.5 is given. Just think of meter and kg, not pound and foot. So the resultant is 330. The sum of all these forces. Then we do moment balance about the x-axis. It is already given that R times ZA is. So what we know is this is known. The right-hand side is known here. Only thing I am interested to find out what is ZD. That is the fourth child. Okay, so right-hand side here is known. So the answer should be for Z. This is the ZD. That is going to be 3.55 meter. And that can be found just by balancing the moment about x-axis. Similarly, if we balance the moment about z-axis, the answer should be 7.03 meter. So we need not to worry about sign also for this problem, because everything is actually on the same side of it. So you can either choose everything positive or everything negative. It does not matter, okay? Sir, bolie na.
E. And that is why it was 7.97.
Oh, okay. Theek hai.
Along x-axis from end E, I have told. And this one is given from other end, sir.
Okay, you told from the end E. Okay. So origin is already given right here. You know, so it is better always to consider x and z-axis as a reference frame whenever you are doing that calculation. Yes, you can choose the origin anywhere. That is not an issue. Yeah. Any question on this? Shall we move to the next one? So it's related to hydrostatic pressure now. See, again, there was a question from the back, I think. The equilibrium approach, someone said that, you know, what is the reaction during the verge of opening, right? So if you think of this problem also, if we think about it, at the verge of opening, the reaction here is actually equals to zero. But we are not following equilibrium here, don't forget. So we have to think in this problem, everything in terms of the resultant force, its direction, and so on and so forth. So water is given on both sides. Remember, there is a weight of the gate also in this case, okay? So there is a weight in the gate as well as there are water levels. Water level difference is there. Now pressure is acting from both sides, okay? So that we have to keep in mind. So what is the pressure distribution in this gate AB? That's the main clue actually. What is that pressure distribution we are looking at on that gate?
Weight of gate is given in submerged condition.
Yes, that's the weight of the body and the, on that condition, yes.
50,000 kg when submerged.
Yes. So what would be the direction of the resultant force? See, I'll just give a quick hint. Weight is acting, right, downward. Just think of this problem when the height is actually same on both sides. If the height remains same, then there is no pressure on the gate, right? So only thing is that we have a weight. Weight is passing through the middle of the gate. Now you keep filling the water, so you make the one side more. So ultimately pressure is coming from the left-hand side, right? And it will actually, now you have a weight here. Weight is going down. Now you keep filling the pressure, no? You keep filling the water, so therefore, we are going to have the force, right, from that pressure distribution that is acted. So ultimately, you have a weight and the force that is coming from the pressure distribution. These two will make a resultant, right? Okay.
The weight of the water doesn't overgate. Downward force of the water. Is above the gate AB. The water force on the downstream side of AB.
One is horizontal force by the right side of the water. One is vertical force above the gate AB, downward force. And self weight of the gate. Three forces should be taken into account.
You can look at it in two ways. For example, there is a force coming from this side. It acts normal to the gate.
And then that is also normal.
It acts normal to the gate, weight is vertical. Now the deal is this, you can do it in two ways. One way is that you find out the complete pressure acting from this side, find out the complete pressure acting from this side, take the resultant should pass through the base in order for it, okay, not having any reaction there. But now note one thing, this problem can be solved in a more intelligent way, is to realize that it is just the difference between these two heights, okay? Because this component from this will be common from this. Only thing that is different is that extra height. So if you do the problem in that way, it can be reduced to just two loads. One is the differential pressure coming from this side, and other is the weight. And the problem becomes a little bit simpler, less prone to errors. Is it fine?
Just the differential height is what important.
Just that the pressure, height makes it difference a height problem. Pressure.
Answer is given already. Okay. So you can solve it in multiple ways, but the main thing would be that what would be the simplest procedure to solve this kind of problem. Okay. So ultimately, think of there will be actually two forces when the gate is about to open. Is coming from the differential height of the water. That pressure, how that pressure will act, that is one thing. And the weight is also there. These are the two forces that is actually contributing to a resultant. That will contribute to a resultant. The resultant must pass through AB. You can also, it is much easier to think from the equilibrium actually than all of this, but we have not covered equilibrium yet. So there can be two approaches here. Okay. Okay, what is the differential force that acts on this gate? Rho g h minus 4 multiplied by the width, that's the differential force. Now that will act like this, and the mg, the weight is like that. So if you apply the triangle rule, ultimate conclusion is that the resultant must pass through this. Right, that's the condition given. See, ultimately, if you think of an equilibrium approach, what will happen? Moment about this to be equals to zero. Of these two forces, one will be coming from the pressure, differential pressure, another one is the weight. If you take the moment about B, you can solve the answer, because at the verge of opening, reaction is also actually zero here.
11.18.
No.
Of water level?
The answer would be, it is 4.5 meter. That's the H, the way it is shown. The answer will be 4.5 meter. I think I'll quickly show the solution. Simple sketch can actually do the job. See, this is the sketch I need. What is the differential pressure distribution here? It is going to be same everywhere, right? So I am going to get a uniformly distributed load. that is rho g h minus 4, because the difference in the height of the water is h minus 4. Therefore, everywhere you go in the gate is going to be same. So that is the, you know, this force is coming from the differential pressure. So rho g h minus 4 multiplied by the width of the gate multiplied by 10, that is your total force. Pressure is rho g h minus 4, right? It is same everywhere in this case. So if I look at the force, that will be simply 10 multiplied by 4, that's the area of the gate, right? 10 multiplied by 4 is the area of the gate, multiplied by rho g h minus 4, okay? Just think this way, what is happening as you keep feeling this, so Fp is gradually increasing. Fp is gradually increasing, therefore your resultant, so initially, let's say, difference is very small between the water level. Ultimately, your R will be somewhere towards the, not along the AB, but it will be just somewhat toward the left of the gate, such that gate is always closed. But you keep filling the water, so Fp magnitude will keep on increasing as per the triangle rule. So Fp magnitude will keep on increasing to an extent when the R is parallel to the gate. So it can be done using simple triangle rule, as long as I know Fp equals to what and Mg equals to what. And those are actually given. Mg is given. Fp we have to find out, that is coming from the force, pressure. That is coming from the pressure, that is the total force. So that's the small part we have to work on. Okay, if you think of equilibrium, we are not doing, but you can think of equilibrium also. Moment about B should be equals to zero from these two forces again. Okay, and that will also give you the 4.5 meters, so that check can be done. Now, this can be given as an equilibrium problem as well as, with this setting. So, ultimately, this angle is what is known to us, this theta, that angle is known. Okay, that is the condition when the resultant is parallel to the AB. Resultant coincides with AB. Okay, I think let's move on to the next one. Next one is, would require some kind of calculations. So in the previous problem, there was no integration required. So no integration was required. In this case, we have to do a little bit, okay? So what is the concept in just one sentence? Just one sentence.
Pressure inside the steel cone is equal to atmospheric pressure.
Wait. So the upward force that is generated by the pressure should be equals to the weight of the cone. So all we have to do, we are just telling students, okay, get me the upward force that is coming from the pressure distribution. Okay, and then we have to adopt the integration approach in this case. Because now you have to take a strip, circumferential, in the circumference of the cone, and we have to integrate it out. 15.7? Answer is 41.8. I'm just giving you the answer. 41.8 kilonewton. If you want the answer in terms of algebraic quantities, it is 4 pi divided by 3, 4 pi divided by 3 multiplied by rho g. Rho is the density and g is the gravitational. So anyone could explain how do you approach for this problem, just quickly?
Hello. The approach will be, we will getting the center of gravity of this cone will be 1/4 of the height from the base, h/4. And the total weight of the water, that is volume into density, that will be, we will take moment about that edge where the slant height is meeting that circle. So we'll balance it and we'll get the height, we'll get this mg.
And don't think of in terms of equilibrium though.
No, sir, area of the base multiplied by the water force, that is a buoyant force which we will be having now, that should be equal to the weight of the cone. That is area of the base.
But how the pressure is acting on the wall?
Pardon?
How the pressure is acting
everything
on
is, everything will be upward only.
Pressure acting on the wall. It is always perpendicular to the surface. What you have to do, take the vertical component.
That will compensate. Whatever is there from the top and bottom, no, that will compensate each other. Only at the base I'm taking, base.
Hello, sir. Sir, if we consider a very small strip at the surface, suppose at a distance r from the top end or the bottom end, that we can consider at a small distance, which is a variable, and that surface area will be 2 pi r into dr in that form. And the pressure is acting that is normal to that surface. We have to take the vertical component only. And then we have to integrate it from the considering a variable height from the bottom to that particular height. Yeah. And that we have to get with the weight of the cone.
Absolutely correct. So that's the answer. It is exactly the same way as we do the, you know, when we set up the problem of a distributed load. Okay, so what we do here, first you create a strip of, that means you take a distance Z, okay, and in that strip, first we make sure what is the pressure and therefore what is the force. So you can think of this strip on the, you know, periphery of that cone on the surface, right? Now there are issues here. The main issue is that there is a slanted height and there is a vertical height, but they are linked. The slanted height, the inclined distance and the vertical height has to be linked because we have to do the integration, and that integration we can go from on the height or on the slanted surface. We have two choices. So in this case, it will be appropriate if we consider a, let's say, distance Z from the top of the cone. So let us find out what is the small force dr. Now that small force dr will act perpendicular to this surface. So that is equals to rho gz, that is the pressure coming for this height z, and then 2 pi r, that's the radius of the cone at that particular height z. Rz is the radius of the cone and 2 pi r is the perimeter multiplied by this distance ds. So that gives the surface area as if of that strip. Okay, so I have a total small force dr which is actually acting perpendicular to that ds, right? And then we take the component of this, so you have to take the component upward, that is fv, vertical force. So that vertical force, whatever we get, is the answer for the weight. Okay, so the finally, remember, we do have to change, you know, there is a s is the slanted height, as I said, and there is a z, but there are relationship exists between z and s because of this angle. So these are, you know, more complex problem, and it's difficult for the student also to absorb that at the beginning, but ultimately, you know, it is a systematic procedure that we are following here. It's the same as that of how we calculate the distributed load. If we have what is the centroid and what is the, you know, area of that distributed load.